السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Let's start with سورة الفاتحة. If you can read along with me, inshallah, that would be great. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الرحمن الرحيم. مالك يوم الدين. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين آمين الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So inshallah, today we want to continue the story of Ibrahim عليه السلام. If you had tuned in last halaqa, we had talked about Ibrahim alayhi salam's early childhood, where he was questioning the culture of his people and the worship of idols that they were engaged in, and he was thinking freely for himself, not giving in to the trends that was being set around him. And we mentioned that, you know, this is a quality that's rare that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and it's, you know, as relevant today as it is back then. You know, now we don't see people worshiping idols, but there's all kinds of trends around us that, you know, that are destructive and harmful, especially on social media. So, you know, to be able to think for yourself and to discern what's good and what's not good, it's a profound gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, we talked about the reaction of his people. When you question, you know, the status quo and you challenge people, and you present the truth to them, there are people who will follow the truth and there are people who are threatened by the truth. And so they rejected Ibrahim alayhi salam. They expelled him. They kicked him out. And he had only one follower from his hometown, Ur, which was his nephew, Lut alayhi salam. And we mentioned his encounter with the king of his area, Namrud, and the dialogue that he had with him. And now Ibrahim alayhi salam presented the argument of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very logical manner. And our ulama, they take a lesson from that, you know, a religion is not based on just superstition and beliefs, but there is a lot of logic and reason and understanding built into it. And so it has a foundational aspect in terms of understanding things. And so, you know, and blindly believing is actually something that's looked down upon. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he actually, you know, dismissed the superstition of the Arabs when the eclipse happened at the death of his son. His son died and the sun was eclipsed. And the Arabs, they had a superstition that the eclipse of the sun happens when somebody great died. So a lot of Arabs became Muslim because of that incident. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out and he said, you know, the sun and the moon are creation of Allah and they don't eclipse for any person. These are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our religion, it doesn't glorify belief that's based on nothing. You know, and it's not all about faith. It's also about reason and understanding. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he presented a very logical argument to Namrud and defeated him. As a result, you know, he was not able to go back to his hometown. So he became a wandering prophet. And the Mufassirin, they mentioned that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he would walk around from town to town, from place to place. And, you know, he got married to a beautiful woman named Sara. And she was also tagging along with him. And his nephew, Lut, alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him on a mission of his own. And he went to a place called Sadum. And he became a prophet there and inviting people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Lut, alayhi salam, he spent the rest of his life in Sadum until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for him to leave. But going back to Ibrahim alayhi salam, we'll talk about Lut alayhi salam on another time, inshallah. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he journeyed with his wife Sarah for many years. And, you know, he became old. But while he was young, they crossed through Egypt. And they crossed through Egypt. And Sarah, she was a very beautiful woman. And the king in Egypt at that time, this was before the Pharaonic area, before the Pharaonic era, there was a kingship in Egypt. The king had a harem. He would love to have all the beautiful women around the world brought to him. And so he, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam somehow got the news. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him about this, that when you're going through this area, so there's some dangers to watch out for. So he told his wife that, you know, if anybody stop us and ask about our relationship, tell them I'm your brother. And then, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam has been told to have mentioned three lies in his lifetime. The first one was when he was told to go to the parade with the idolaters, and he said, I am sick, you know, and he meant, I'm sick of what you're doing, but that was counted as a lie for him. And the second one, when he broke the idols and he hung the axe on the biggest one, they asked, you know, who broke the idols? He said, the biggest one did it. And even though he was trying to make a point, that was counted as a lie. And the third one was when he told his wife, when they ask you about a relationship, tell them, I'm your brother. Now, of course, in our religion, you know, when you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's a fraternity of brotherhood and sisterhood. So it's not really a lie, but it was counted against him, alayhi salam, not in a way that Allah wouldn't forgive, but he felt guilty in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he lied in his lifetime. So he only lied how many times? Three times. And with that three times, he felt like, you know, he's, you know, shame on the day of judgment. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when the people come asking the prophets to come and intercede for them in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibrahim alayhi salam says, go to someone else because I lied in my life three times. La ilaha illallah. So he's afraid to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of something minute that we don't think anything about. So anyway, before we continue, our scholars, they said, you know, when it comes to lying, lying is a form of speech in which a person, you know, tends to bend the truth or do something or make up some story. And our ulama, they said it's considered sinful except in three cases. When you're trying to make peace between people or between a husband and a wife who's maintaining a peace, or when you're in a military situation and you're trying to save people's life. Other than that, they said it's considered something blameworthy and something that is considered sinful. And our ulama, they also mentioned that, you know, the fuqaha, they mentioned the purpose of speech is to, you know, arrive to a certain, you know, explain the truth or to bring to a certain understanding. But when, if you can reach that conclusion by speaking the truth, then that is the preferred way. But if you're not able to speak the truth or, you know, there's something preventing you or there's a danger or something, in those cases, they said, you know, it becomes not permissible, but it necessary. In those cases, it's forgiven. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our lies. But anyway, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he took truth very seriously. And so what happened now? He tells his wife, if anybody stop us and ask you what's our relationship, tell them, I am your brother. Now, why did he do that? If, you know, the purpose of the people stopping him, hold on 1 second, my son is knocking on the door. 1 second. Sorry about that. So when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he goes to Egypt with his wife, the king, of course, his posse, they find out there's this beautiful woman walking by. We should capture her and present her as a slave to the king. And the king will be very happy with us and give us a reward. So the soldiers of the king, they have this idea. So they stop Ibrahim alayhi salam and they ask, you know, who is this woman to you? He says to them, she's my sister. And then they ask his wife, who is this man to you? He says, he's my brother. And so they send him off his way and they capture his wife and they take her away. Now, Ibrahim alayhi salam, in this situation, of course, any man would have his blood boiling. Ibrahim alayhi salam is calm and collected because he has knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that reassures him that everything's going to be okay. And he's in a complete state of submission because he knows nothing is going to come to you except that it is from Allah. And whatever happens, there's some goodness behind it, even though you and I are not able to see it. And being a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has conviction of this reality. So they arrest Ibrahim alayhi salam's wife. And the reason, you know, he says she's my sister and she said he's my brother is if she has a husband, you know, and they know that she has a husband, they know that the husband is likely to come looking for her and is going to cause trouble at the palace. So they might kill her on the spot. Can you hear me? Yusuf Yahya says, I can't hear you. Okay. Let me kick my children out. 1 second. Guys, go upstairs, please. Alhamdulillah. I have five kids. Please forgive me. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he doesn't want to be killed, of course. At the same time, he has complete trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plans. So they arrest her and they take her to the palace, and the king is infatuated with her. Our mother Sarah, she was very beautiful. And so the king tries to approach her, and she's such a pious woman, she doesn't want to be touched by any man. And so what happens? She makes dua. She says, Ya Allah, keep this man's evil away from me. As soon as she makes the dua, the man is approaching her, the king. Suddenly, he just falls to the floor, limp like a vegetable. He becomes paralyzed. And he goes, what kind of witchcraft is this? What did you do to me? So he begs her for forgiveness and says, I won't do anything. I'll set you free. Just undo whatever you did. She said, I didn't do anything except ask the Lord of the heavens and the earth to protect me from your evil. He says, whatever it is, just undo it, and then I'll let you go. So she makes dua, Ya Allah, let's release him. And as soon as he's released, he still, is overcome by his animal nature and his desire for her. So he tries to approach her a second time. And as he's getting closer to her, she asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for protection again. And again, he becomes paralyzed. And this is something profound to let you and me know, because people make up lies about our mother Sarah. They said she was a jealous woman and all that stuff, and she plotted against somebody else. So they made up all these lies. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is informing us here that she was so pious, she was so righteous, that her dua, as soon as she would make the dua, it was accepted. And imagine having that kind of power, Whatever you ask for, Allah does it for you instantaneously. Yet she lived alone with her husband, traveling from place to place, from town to town. They didn't have their own house to settle down in, didn't have children. So she could have asked for anything, but she didn't. And there is a wisdom and lesson behind that. Our scholars just said that your life is unfolding in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And so when you let go of whatever you want for the sake of what Allah wants, that is of the highest level of character. And she has the most utmost level of character. Tarkul talab min khayrul adab, they said. Letting go of what asking is actually from the pinnacle of adab. And so she's got that kind of, gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever she asked for is granted, but she didn't ask for anything. But in this case, she asked Allah to protect her because her honor is important for her. And it's important for a Muslim woman to protect her honor and her dignity, because this is something sacred that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon the woman. And so the king starts begging her again, please release me. I will not do it again, I promise, and he's begging and begging. So she says, Ya Allah, it's okay, release him. And so he's begging again, he's able to move his hands and his feet, and he leaves her alone for a couple of days. And then again, he sees her, he becomes overwhelmed by her beauty. So he wants to approach her a third time, and he thinks it's not going to happen. Third time is the charm. She makes dua again. What happens? He becomes paralyzed. And so he starts thinking she's some kind of witch, a demonic person, whatever, right? So he starts pleading with her, if you do undo it, I promise this time I will not do anything. I'll let you go. And finally, she gives in. She says, Ya Allah, release him. As soon as he's released, he gives her a gift. Please don't hurt me anymore. He gives her a gift. He gives her some money, he gives her some clothes, he gives her some gold, and he gives her a slave. And then he says, please leave my country, go. I don't want you around Egypt. So she goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam with wealth, with clothing, with and a slave woman named Hajar. And this was all given to her as a gift. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought this very, very scary situation to a beautiful and good conclusion. And she comes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam and they leave Egypt. Now they lived together for many years. And Hajar alayhi salam, after Sarah alayhi salam, she's proven to be barren and they can't have any children. She gives her slave Hajar as a gift to Ibrahim alayhi salam. She says, oh Ibrahim, I can't give you any children. So I know how much you want to have children. So I want you to marry Hajar. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam, he gets married with Hajar alayhi salam, and it's it's perfectly acceptable to have more than one wife. Even in the Quran, there's a permission given, but within certain circumstances, within certain conditions. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he now marries Hajar alayhi salam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them a child. Now, guess how old Ibrahim alayhi salam is when he marries her? He is in his 80s. He's an old man. And Sarah alayhi salam has also reached an age of maturity, and her hair has turned gray. And so when he marries her, it is a miracle of miracles that at that old age, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him a child. And what's interesting is Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's known for his devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His whatever happens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes first. Whatever tests, whatever trials, whatever tribulations, whatever desires, whatever wants, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always first in his lifetime. And so he's really dedicated to putting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before anything else. And so the angels in the sky are praising Ibrahim alayhi salam. And shaitan is like, ya Allah, this is not possible. How is this person going to put you first in all these situations? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'll show you. As soon as the baby is born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Ibrahim alayhi salam, take your wife and your baby and travel to the desert and leave them there. Ibrahim alayhi salam is traveling with his wife and his baby. And this is where the Bani Israel, they make up stories like Sarah became jealous of Hajar and he wanted the baby killed, and he convinced Ibrahim alayhi salam to get rid of her and get rid of him, and that's why he left them in the desert. No, nothing like that. The only reason he took them to the desert is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him. And when you leave a woman and a child in the desert with no means of making food, you know, producing anything, what does that really spell out? Certain death, right? There's no McDonald's, there's nothing around. So if you leave somebody in the middle of the desert, they're going to die of hunger and thirst. But Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's being tested. You know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved your wife Hajar, Sarah, from that, you know, dire situation and brought her back to you, you saw that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can undo whatever happens and bring it, you know, to be something good. Do you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can bring your wife and child back to you if you leave them in the middle of the desert? This is the test. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Ibrahim alayhi salam, go and leave your wife and your son in the middle of the desert. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he has complete conviction that even if I leave them here, the desert is inhospitable, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is generous. The desert kills, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life. The desert doesn't, you know, has no food or water, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's ar-Razzaq and he will provide. So he brings his wife Hajar and brings his son Ismail alayhi salam as a baby. He's a newborn baby. Brings him into the middle of the desert. He turns around and he tells his wife Hajar. He says, Hajar, I would like you to stay here with the baby and I have to go. And he turns around and starts walking away. And of course, the humanity in him, his heart is filled with emotions. Tears are rolling down his eyes. And he's walking away. And Hajar, she's like shocked. She says, Ibrahim, you're going to leave us here in the middle of the desert? There's nothing here. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is just walking away slowly and slowly, slowly. And he's feeling, you know, his heart just boiling up with emotions. And she chases after him. Ibrahim, don't leave us here. What are you doing? We're going to, you know, there's nothing here. And Ibrahim alayhi salam keeps on walking away. And she says, oh, Ibrahim, did Allah tell you to leave us here? Ibrahim alayhi salam stops. He says, yes, it is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she says, if Allah is the one who told you to do this, then Allah will take care of us. You go. Go on without us. And she is also a woman of deep conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is very clear in the history, in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that our mother Hajar, was a woman of deep devotion. And her name Hajar actually comes from Hijra. You know what Hijra is? Hijra is to immigrate from one place to another place. But Hajar is a woman who had immigrated for the sake of Allah. In other words, she had left everything evil and everything bad, and she had moved towards everything good and everything praiseworthy. And so this was her quality. There was nothing in her character that could have been said to be blameworthy. And she was a very noble woman. So she says, go on without us. Allah will take care of us. And if you look around, there's nothing except sand. The blue sky and the yellow sand. That's it. In all directions across the horizon. And so she has complete reliance and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah will take care of her. Ibrahim alayhi salam leaves and he's gone. And she's sitting there with her baby. And she's spending time with him. And she's feeding the baby. and her milk starts to dry out. And Ibrahim alayhi salam had left with her some pouch of water and some dates. The dates run out, the water runs out, and the baby becomes so hungry, he starts to cry. And the babies, when they cry, they have different cries. Like when they're uncomfortable, there's a certain cry. But when they get really like hurting stomach or something bad, the cry has a deeper intensity. And when they're in a state of dire need, the baby's cry is unbearable. Like anybody hears that baby crying, their heart's going to shatter, right? So Ismail alayhi salam, as a baby, he starts crying in that extreme mode, you know, the emergency cry. And as a mother, you know, who's got a heart of mercy and compassion and softness, she cannot bear to see her child in that state. So even though she believes that Allah will take care of her and Allah will take care of her baby, when she sees Ismail alayhi salam starving and crying and you know, kicking with his feet and you know, in that dire and desperate state, she enters into a state of panic. And so what she does is she starts running up the mountains. She starts running up one hill, coming back down, running up another hill. And she's just running back and forth looking for help. And she runs up one mountain. She calls out for help. Anybody there that can help us? Is there anyone that's there that can help us? No reply. Her own voice is echoing back to her. She comes back down. She goes up to the other mountain and she's shouting, is there anyone that can help us? Is there anyone? And there's no reply. And she's coming back and forth, and she climbs these two hills, and they're known as Safa and Marwa, 7 times. She climbs them 7 times back and forth, and finally she, you know, she gets to a state where she slaps herself in the face. She says, stop, stop, you know, calm down. She turns around, and she looks at where she left Ismail alayhi salam with her belongings, and Ismail alayhi salam has gone quiet. And, you know, she's feeling maybe he died, something happened to him. She takes a closer look and she sees there's this being standing over him, right? Huge wings, light being. And, you know, and she thinks maybe this is the angel of death, maybe something's going on. So she rushes down to her baby at full speed and she finds, as soon as she gets there, whatever being was over him disappears. And this was Angel Jibreel alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent Jibreel alayhi salam to bring out from the ground water. And the water came out from where the foot of Ismail alayhi salam was kicking the ground. And the word Ismail means the one Allah heard. Ismail means the one whom Allah had heard. And the water is gushing out of the ground and baby is calm and collected and he's happy. Like all his pain and suffering had been taken away and now there's water for them. So she comes down and she's still in that mode. You know, when you enter into a heightened state, like for example, you think somebody ate your cookies, right? And you become angry, like who ate my cookies? And you're rushing up and down, who ate my cookies? And then you find your cookies. That anger doesn't leave you right away. It stays with you until you slowly calm down. So even though she was all her problems solved, the water is there and everything, that panic didn't leave her. You know, it's until she slowly calms down. So she's still in a state of panic. She starts building walls around the water. And she's like saying, stop, stop, zam, 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 zam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, may Allah have mercy on our mother Hajar. Had she left that water alone, it would have become a flowing river. But this water is one of the miracles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to Ismail alayhi salam and our mother Hajar alayhi salam. And it's a symbolic of the blessing that's going to come from their lineage. And the water represents one of the waters of Jannah that's been given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's a very short surah in the Quran about this water, not about Zamzam, but about the water of Jannah. What is it called? Take a guess. Inna a'tayna kal-kawthar. We have given you al-kawthar. The kawthar is a heavenly water that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave its mirror image in the world as the water of Zamzam. And anybody who drinks from it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, anyone who drinks from the kawthar is wind quenched for the rest of their lives. And in this world, the Zamzam here is symbolic of what's coming to Arabia. And who's coming to Arabia? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's going to bring Islam that's going to quench the thirst of billions of people. And they're going to drink from this message and they're going to be brought out of the desert of heedlessness and they're going to be brought into the shade of Islam. And so this is a very symbolic moment where this water is now gushing out from the desert. which was a place of death in an inhospitable environment. Now there's water and there's life. And so Hajar alayhi salam, she's there with her baby, and they're drinking from this water. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us about the water of Zamzam. Whatever intention you drink it with, it is for that. And there's a one story of a companion who came looking for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they beat him up. And you know, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was he was preaching in secret. And so when he came and he started asking about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Quraysh, they beat him up until his legs were broken, and he was just sitting there on the street by the well of Zamzam. And he said he just started drinking from the water of Zamzam, and he had no food for about a month. And he said he started getting rolls of fat on his belly just from the nourishment of the Zamzam itself. Allahu Akbar. And our ulama, they mentioned the Prophet ﷺ said, if you drink it with the intention of shifa, healing, it is healing. If you drink it with the intention of purification, it is purification. If you drink it with the intention of forgiving your sins, it is forgiveness. So it's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the miracle of it is, it's a very small well in Arabia right now. And it's underground sourced. It's sourced from underground. And millions and millions of people, they drink from it every single day, and it never ran out from the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So anyway, continuing on. Now she's there with her baby, and there's a caravan going by the desert. And this tribe is coming from Yemen, called Jurhum. This is a tribe of Jurhum. They're coming from Yemen, and they see birds in the sky. And the desert, birds in the sky means water. Because birds, they don't go to empty, desert lands. They hover usually around water. So somehow birds appeared there, and now they're hovering over this water. So they look to each other. Their tracker says, I've been through this route many times. I never seen water in that area. Let's go check it out. So they turn this caravan around, and they go to this area where Hajar alayhi salam is there with her baby, and they stop by to see, sure enough, there's water gushing out of the ground. And what's interesting here is these are desert dwellers. These are Bedouins from the lands of Yemen. And these are Arabs. Our Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was not Arab. And our father, Ismail alayhi salam, he was not Arab. But these Jurhumites, they are Arabs from Yemen. And they come with the Arabic language. And they start communicating with our mother Hajar. And they ask her permission to drink from the water. And what's amazing is our ulama, they said these were very noble and very manly people. That even though they saw a woman with her baby, they could have overpowered her. They could have just taken the water. They could have just, enslaved them, whatever. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put it in their hearts to be noble and to be a gentleman and to ask for permission. And what's more profound is that when they ask for permission, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that our mother Hajar, she gave them permission with a condition. She said, you may drink from the water, but it belongs to us. In other words, this is our water. If we want to sell it to you, we can sell it to you. If we want to deny you, we can deny you, but we give you permission. And so she had this courage to stand up and to claim what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her. And when she made that claim, nobody challenged her. So this water then belonged to the family of our mother Hajar alayhi salam and the baby that was to grow up there, Ismail alayhi salam. And the water was so pure and so clean that the Jurhumites, they said, we should set up camp here, and have like an outpost, and maybe we can do some things here. So what they did is they start setting up little tents around that place, and it eventually became a city around that water. And there was a settlement around the water of Zamzam, and these are Arabic-speaking Jurhumites. So Ismail alayhi salam, he grew up speaking Arabic, which he learned from the Jurhumites. And they loved him. He was very sweet to them. He was very, very, And so Ibrahim alayhi salam is now told to come back and visit his wife and his son. And when Ismail alayhi salam comes back, he finds there is a city there. He finds that there are people there, and there is trade happening, and caravans coming and leaving. And he finds his son has now reached an age of maturity. His son has reached the age of puberty. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, it was his dream to always to have somebody that he could teach to about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he was a prophet that was always alone by himself with his wife. And so now his dream is coming true, that he has a son now that he can pass this messengership onto, that he can teach him in the ways of prophethood. And so he's very excited to teach his son. So he comes to stay some, you know, spend some time with his son, and he spends, you know, teaching his son some things. And after he's teaching his son and he's building this bond and everything, he starts seeing dreams. And he sees in a dream that he's got his son and he's slaughtering him. And the dreams of the prophets are not like regular people's dreams. You know, these are revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he sees this dream one time. He sees this dream second time, third time. So finally, he comes to his son and he says, Ya abati, inni ara fil manami anni azbahuka. Fanzur madha tara. He says to his son, oh my son, you know, I see in my dream that I'm slaughtering you. What do you think? Give me your opinion. Now, what's interesting here is the Bani Israel, they made up stories that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was keeping secrets from his son, and that he was sneaking around and he was trying to find a way where his son wasn't paying attention to come and kill him while he's not looking. You know, all of that stuff is false. They made it up. Ibrahim alayhi salam comes to his son and he asks him, what do you think? This is what I'm seeing in my dreams. And Ismail alayhi salam, profound reply. He says, Ya abati, if'al ma tu'maru satajudini insha'Allah min as-sabirin. This is in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Safat that Ismail alayhi salam, even though he's a young 12-year-old or 13-year-old child, he tells his father, oh my father, do whatever you're commanded to do. You will find me, insha'Allah, patient. What is he telling his father? If Allah wants to take my life, my father, go ahead and take my life. He's willing to give up his life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in that short time that Ibrahim alayhi salam was teaching him about Allah, did he teach him well? What do you think? He taught him to a level where Ismail alayhi salam is ready to give up his life. Ya Allah, if you want my life is yours. Go ahead and take it. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is being asked to slaughter his son, even though he was just having all these hopes and dreams that he's going to grow up and be this great prophet, and he's going to lead the nation, and he's going to do all these great things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling him, no, Ibrahim, you're going to sacrifice him for me. And this is a very big test, right? Ibrahim alayhi salam already went through a similar test, left him in the desert, right? Already went through another test, let his wife go with the soldiers. Already went through, now he's being tested. Slaughter your son. This is a very, very difficult challenge. But Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail alayhi salam, they both submit and they surrender. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ وَنَادَيْنَاهُ أَيَّا إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِ الْمُحْسَنِينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when they both submitted and surrendered themselves, Ibrahim alayhi salam got the knife and he closed his eyes. He doesn't know, he doesn't want to see what he's about to do. But his son, he stretched out his neck, and Ibrahim alayhi salam put the knife to the neck of his son, and his heart is in that state that it is in. You know, he's about to slaughter his son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Falamma aslama," when they surrendered. So they're in that, he's about to pull the knife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls out to him, "Ya Ibrahim," angels appear in front of him. Oh Ibrahim. Now before that moment, while he's walking to the place of slaughter, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Shaitan kept appearing in front of him. And Shaitan kept telling him, oh Ibrahim, are you going to kill your son? What is this? What Allah wants from you? This is barbaric. This is evil. Don't do that. Don't listen to this. This is not right. You're probably misinterpreting this. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is being challenged by Shaitan to not do this. And what he's about to do is, Shaitan is telling him, what you're about to do is very evil. And what's amazing is our scholars said Shaitan was telling Ibrahim alayhi salam that what Ibrahim alayhi salam is about to do, obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is evil. Because on the surface, he's being told to slaughter his son. Now, if I tell you, go and slaughter somebody, is that evil or not? Yes or no? Yes, it's evil. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands, and the person is a messenger of Allah, he's been receiving messages from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have no doubt that this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who determines what's good and what's evil? You and I? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah, he determines what's good and what's evil. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes certain foods halal and certain foods haram? He created them. He decides what's halal and what's haram, right? There is wisdom behind it. If you investigate it, you find that if you eat pork, there's bad consequences. It has harm to your body. But ultimately, it's not because of those wisdoms. It's because who said so? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said so. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to do something, and shaitan is telling him, this is evil. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he knows better. He's not going to fall to the tricks of shaitan. So what he does, he picks up pebbles and he throws it at shaitan. Get away from me, shaitan, right? And shaitan runs away. So this keeps on happening until Ibrahim alayhi salam pulls the knife. And he pulls the knife at the throat of his son, and his eyes are closed. He feels the blood, and the angels are all around him and they're congratulating him. Oh, Ibrahim, you have fulfilled the dream. Oh, Ibrahim, you have fulfilled the dream. And he looks down, and he sees his hands are covered in blood, but it's not his son's blood. Instead of his son, he has in his hand a ram. And he finds his son is standing next to him. Allahu Akbar, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically reveals to him that Allah does not want to, you know, take the son, life of your son. Allah does not want to take you away from your family. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to destroy your hopes and dreams. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always will test you. Are you going to put Allah first? Are you going to put your family first? Are you going to put Allah first? Are you going to put your wealth first? Are you going to put Allah first? Are you going to put your video games first? Are you going to put your stock market first? What's going to come first in your lifetime? And so, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ. His Lord, he told him, submit yourself, surrender yourself, means give up your will for Allah's will. Give up your wants for Allah's wants. And Ibrahim alayhi salam said, "Qala aslamtu li rabbil alamin." I surrender myself to the Lord of the heavens and the earth. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam, he passed the test. He gets to keep his son. Allahu Akbar. Right? And his son is with him. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Ibrahim alayhi salam another great grand news. Oh Ibrahim, you know, we have another news for you. Your wife Sarah, she's going to have a child also. How old is she at this point? She's in her 90s. Right, Ibrahim alayhi salam is also very old. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is like, what? She's going to have a child? But this news comes to him at a different moment. And we're going to tell you in a moment. When Ibrahim alayhi salam is told to go back, he goes back to his wife Sarah's place and he's spending some time there. And three of these angels, they come in the form of men. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he thinks these are guests and they're traveling. So he invites them to his house. He slaughters a sheep for them. And now this is sunnah, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him to slaughter sheep, to slaughter an animal to make, you know, the meat as a sacrifice. So he slaughters an animal for them and he makes them this nice roasted meat, you know, the T-bone steaks and all that stuff. And he offers it to them and they don't eat. And in that time, in that area, if somebody you offer them food to, they don't eat your food, it means they are intending some harm to you. And if they eat your food, then they will be indebted to you and they're not going to harm you. So when they don't eat the food Ibrahim alayhi salam had prepared for them, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he feels kind of like, you know, unease inside himself. Are they here to rob me? Are they here to kill me? What are their intentions? He doesn't know. So these men, they say, don't be afraid. We're here as messengers from your Lord. And we're here to tell you that we're going to the town of Sodom. Ibrahim alayhi salam says, what are you going to Sodom for? He says, Allah has given us the command to destroy the people of Sodom. What happened at Sodom? We're going to talk about it later. But something happened there that these angels are going to destroy this entire nation. Ibrahim alayhi salam says, don't destroy them. Lut is there. You know, he's a prophet of Allah too. He's there. He's taking care of them. He's teaching them. The angels say, this is something that has been already decreed and we have no say in it. And, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's in a state of shock. And then, you know, somebody's listening inside. Our mother Sarah is listening and she starts laughing. Says, these people, I knew they had it coming. And she's happy that they're about to get destroyed. And when she laughs, our scholar, this is recorded in the Quran, that she laughed when she heard this news. So the scholar said, what's amazing here is that there's this epic battle happening between good and falsehood, between the forces of righteousness and the forces of evil, between people of morality and the people of immorality. And when the people of immorality, they become transgressors and they start threatening and they start, you know, causing all kinds of harm to the people, you should in your heart desire that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring victory. And that victory can come in different ways. Either they become Muslim and they change their ways, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes their destruction. So either they become good or they become destroyed. Either they become destroyed in this world or in the hereafter. Right? So at your heart, you should always desire that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets rid of evil. If it's the evil inside them, then get rid of them. If the evil will not leave them alone, then get rid of the people of evil. And so this was her, you know, and she was happy that they're going to get destroyed. And when the angels, they hear her voice, they said, oh, and we have another news for you. Your wife, Sarah, she's going to have a son. And her son's name is going to be Ishaq. And he will have another child, and his name will be Yaqub. And when she hears this, she slaps her face. She says, she slaps her face. She can't believe what she's hearing. She slaps her face and she says, an old woman and barren have a child? Like, how is this possible? And the angels, they say, this is a matter of decreed. If Allah wants to make something happen, He'll make it happen. Right? And sure enough, now Ibrahim alayhi salam, after he passed the test with Ismail alayhi salam, he has a son. Ishaq alayhi salam is born. And what's amazing is, who came first? Ismail alayhi salam or Ishaq alayhi salam? Ismail alayhi salam. فَبَشَّرْنَاهُ بِغُلَامٍ حَلِيمٍ. This is mentioned in the Quran. Ismail alayhi salam's quality, he was halim. Halim means somebody who's very gentle and very kind. And after that saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the sacrifice and the story of the sacrifice. And then he says, he gave him فَبَشَّرْنَهَا بِإِسْحَاقُ وَمِنْ وَرَاءِ إِسْحَاقِ يَعْقُوبُ. Then Allah gave him glad tidings of Ishaq and after Ishaq Yaqub. Some of the people from Bani Israel, they saw that the sacrifice of Ismail alayhi salam was a great honor bestowed upon the lineage of Ismail alayhi salam. So they said, we don't want this kind of honor to go to them. So they changed the story and they said, actually, the one who was to be sacrificed is not Ismail, but Ishaq. And they hated on Ismail alayhi salam, and they said, Ismail, he became an idolater and he became a corrupt person and he beat his mother. And they made up all these stories. Why? Because they wanted the attention to go from Ismail alayhi salam to Ishaq alayhi salam. Why did they do that? Because they wanted all the honor and the lineage and the prophethood to stay within the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salam. Because the son of Ishaq alayhi salam, his name is Yaqub. And one of the nicknames of Yaqub alayhi salam is Israel. And they're known as Bani Israel, the children of Israel. And all the other prophets, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored both of the sons of Ibrahim alayhi salam, all the prophets, they came from the lineage of Yaqub alayhi salam. So they're all Bani Israel. Dawood alayhi salam, Zakariya alayhi salam, Yahya alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam. They all come from which lineage? From the family of Israel, Yaqub alayhi salam. The only one prophet that came from the family of Ismail alayhi salam is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. But they didn't want even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam to come from that lineage. They wanted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam to be from Bani Israel. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upset them and brought Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the lineage of Ismail alayhi salam, they didn't accept him. They rejected him. They said he can't be a prophet of Allah because he's not from us. Right? They were very, very adamant about being the chosen people. And the reason they got to that level of arrogance is because some people in their history, they changed the stories. They said it was Ishaq that was sacrificed and Ismail became an idolater and all these things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rejects all their claims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Ismail alayhi salam. كَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. Ismail alayhi salam, he was always telling his family to establish the prayer and to give zakah. And he was raising Muslim families. And in one of the narrations, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam told us, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he visited Ismail alayhi salam. And Ismail alayhi salam was not home. And so his wife opened the door. And his wife is one of the Jurhumite Arabs. And Ismail alayhi salam, because Ibrahim alayhi salam hadn't been there for a long time, his wife, she didn't know who this old man is. So he asked her, where is Ismail home? And she said, no, he's not home. He's working, you know, he's busy and all that stuff. So he asked, you know, how's your life? Everything okay? And she started complaining, you know, our life is not easy. You know, we're living in the desert and we don't have all kinds of, our neighbors have a bigger house than us. I've been telling Ismail to get a bigger house, but he's always stuck in this little house. And, you know, we don't have the camels like these other guys. Our camel's sick, you know. And she kept on complaining, complaining, complaining. And Ibrahim alayhi salam listened to her and listened to her and listened to her. And she's going off about the food, about this, about that. Finally, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, I have to go, but when Ismail comes back, please let him know to change his doorstep. You know the mat at the door. So he gives her a coded message. Tell him to change his doorstep. So he leaves. And our ulama, they also mentioned, how was Ibrahim alayhi salam traveling back and forth, right? At a certain point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave, you know, and this is according to the Mufassirin, Ibrahim alayhi salam was riding the Buraq, which was the mount of the prophets, which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam gets to ride in his life also. But Ibrahim alayhi salam is, for him, going from Jerusalem to Arabia is a split second journey. You know, he's gifted by all these spiritual things. So he tells his wife, when he comes back, tell him to change the doorstep. Nighttime, Ismail alayhi salam comes. He's tired from work, but he has a sense like something happened today. You know, because the aura of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam is still there. So he says to his wife, anybody visit us today? She says, yeah, this old man came and, you know, I talked to him a little bit. He was a nice guy, you know, he listened to me. But did he say anything? She says, yeah, he told me to change the doorstep. He says, that was my father and he's telling me to divorce you. So bye. He divorces her. You know, and some of the people they take this as an evidence that, you know, your father or your mother can interfere in your marriage and say, I don't like your wife, you should divorce your wife. And you have to listen to them because Ismail alayhi salam came home and what did he do? He divorced his wife. But the fuqaha, they said, no, this is not the way to understand the story. If your father is Ibrahim alayhi salam, then no problem. If he tells you divorce your wife, divorce your wife, you know, it doesn't matter. But you know, nobody comes between a husband and a wife except shaitan. And so if you have a problem between husband and wife, you have to work it out. But in this case, Ibrahim alayhi salam, whenever prophets say something, it's not from them. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here the lesson is about gratitude, to be grateful, whatever your situation is. And if you're not grateful, you're gonna lose the whatever blessings you have. And this woman, she had one of the greatest blessings. She had a prophet as a husband. Ismail alayhi salam was a prophet and she was not patient with him. She was giving him hard time and she, you know, so it was a very clear lesson on gratitude. And if you're not grateful for the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are bound to lose those blessings. And so she lost the blessing and it came through Ibrahim alayhi salam's advice, but ultimately Ismail alayhi salam divorced her. But the people of Jurhum, they loved Ismail alayhi salam. So they married him, another one woman. And of course, they had a beautiful Muslim family. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the dynamic of their relationship. وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ He used to tell his family to establish the prayer and give the zakah. So he raised a righteous Muslim family. And of course, the accusations the Bani Israel made up against them, they're all false. You know, that his family was evil and all that stuff. That's not true at all. And so Ismail alayhi salam, he has a very righteous family. And this goes on like that for generations after him. But we're going to stop here. We have 10 minutes for questions and answers. There is a lot more to be said about that era. And next time, I think we're going to zoom in on what happened in Sodom and the story of Lut alayhi salam. But any questions? Yusuf Yahya was having a hard time listening, but alhamdulillah, it's working now. Any questions? You can ask about anything. It doesn't have to be related to the stories.
You know my brother, right?
Who's your brother?
Hamza Sayyid Yahya.
Maybe I do, if I see him.
Okay.
That's your question?
Yeah.
That's a good question, alhamdulillah. You know, it doesn't matter who we know. What's important is Allah, He knows all of us. And when you're engaging in seeking knowledge, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that Allah will send angels directly to you. If you leave your house, these angels, they spread their wings for you. And so you walk on their wings. They're doing that out of honor for you. If you're sitting in your home, they shade you with their wings and they make dua for you. Until the fish in the ocean start making dua for you. So Allah, He knows that you attended this program and you want to know more about Islam. And alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, this is glad tidings for all of us. Say alhamdulillah. Any other questions? Please share the purpose behind stoning the shaitan during Hajj. Okay, so when we go to Hajj now, we're doing certain rites and rituals. Those rites and rituals, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made dua asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach him. وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ. So when he made that dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him certain rites and traditions to do in the performance of Hajj. But what's interesting is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored Ibrahim alayhi salam and his wife, and he brought back events from their life and made it into the journey of Hajj. So the stoning of shaitan that we do in the Hajj today, where we throw the stone at the minarets, is actually exact location Ibrahim alayhi salam threw the stones at shaitan when shaitan was trying to prevent him from obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a symbolic gesture that the truth will prevail and shaitan has no power over it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a force that will even hurt the shayateen. But it's not necessarily that stone that you're throwing rocks at is the shaitan itself. And sometimes people go crazy when they go to Hajj. You know, I've seen somebody when I went to Hajj, he was throwing his shoes, saying, Kamina, he's cursing out the stone, shaitan is throwing his shoes. But if you follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that hurts the shaitan more than if you go crazy and start throwing bricks, because chances are you'll hurt somebody doing that. But the purpose of it, it's a symbolic gesture that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed us and gave us the power to ward shaitan away from ourselves. And the real stones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us that will pelt shaitan in any situation you're in, doesn't have to be at Hajj only. In any moment when shaitan comes to you, you can stone him and turn him away is by saying, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran, وَإِمَّا يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Whenever shaitan comes to you with his nazgh means like he starts agitating your heart, he starts turning you against people. فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ, seek refuge in Allah. Say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And that's like throwing stones, like missiles at shaitan. And then Allah says, إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And Allah is listening. Every time you seek refuge in Him, Allah will give you refuge. And so this is the purpose behind that. I hope that answers that question. Do we know how long the lifespans were of the people during the time of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam? Based on the seerah of Ibrahim alayhi salam, I would say maybe around 150 years or 160 years. But in terms of scientific research and carbon dating and all that stuff, we don't have that. But we have the footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and you can see his footprint, Maqam Ibrahim at the Hajj. If you go there, his feet were huge. Right? These are massive feet. So obviously, human beings were of a different stature and of course, different lifespan as a result also. But we don't have concrete scientific evidence to prove that. But based on the seerah, we could guesstimate around 150, 160 years old. Where did the black stone gem come from? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is a stone that came from Jannah. In other words, it was a meteor that came down from the sky. And its origins are spiritual. It's not from the physical universe. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when it came down, it used to be white. But when the people touched it with their sins, the stone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed it to absorb their sins. So it became black over time. And what's interesting is its blackness is not as a result of dirt. Like, you know, when you play in the mud, you get blackened with the dirt. It's not like that. It's crystallized inside it. So it's happening at a molecular level. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows its mysteries. There's a lot behind it. We don't know. But its origins is from the heavenly realms. But we haven't talked about the story of the building of the Kaaba yet. Why are you guys jumping ahead? Also, do we know which specific three angels visited Ibrahim alayhi salam? Some of the scholars, they said it was Jibril alayhi salam and two other angels. Other, some of them specify Israfil alayhi salam and Israel alayhi salam and Mikael alayhi salam. But Allahu alam. But the angel that delivered Allah's punishments as well as the brought Allah's messages to the messengers was Jibril alayhi salam. So Jibril alayhi salam was there with the three angels. But the angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, in Surah Maryam, for example, when Jibril alayhi salam came to Maryam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا. The angel came in the form, تَمَثَّل is the word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used. The angel came taking the form of a well-proportioned man. And so the angels, they can take the form of any man. And the word that's used for the angels taking form is tamathul. The jinn can also take form, but the word used for the jinn taking form is tashakkul. They take the shakl. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, embodies some of his attributes in his servants, in his creation. And that's called tajalli. Tajalli is Allah manifesting his attributes in the creation. For example, you see life, right? You're alive. This is from Allah's life that's appearing inside you. So the difference between, and this, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests his attributes, this is beyond comparison to anything. But this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about the different qualities in the creation. But the angels and the jinn taking form, our ulama, they said, the difference between tamathul and tashakkul is that when an angel takes a form, the form does not rule over the angel. So if an angel comes in the form of a man and you stab him, he's not going to die. It's just going to go right through him and he's going to look at you and smile. So this is not how it works. But if a jinn takes a form, and this is tashakkul, and you kill the form, the jinn dies with it because the form rules over the jinn. So if the Prophet said, if a jinn comes to you in the form of a snake or a scorpion, tell it to leave three times. If it doesn't leave, then you can kill it and you're not held accountable. Anyway, we don't want to get into jinn stories. We have 2 minutes. Any other questions? I don't see any other questions. No more questions?
I have a quick question.
Sure.
So when Prophet Ibrahim was leaving Hazrat Hajar in the desert, is there a reason why he didn't initially tell her what the reason was? He started just like walking away without telling her. And then, she asked him, is it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you to? And then he told her. So I was just wondering, maybe if she had never like asked herself, like she might never have known that it was due to instruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah, I mean, so exactly how did it play out? This is unknown to us. It's lost in the pages of history. As they say, it's unseen, right? But some of the scholars, they said that Ibrahim alayhi salam was only commanded to take her and the baby and travel somewhere else. And while they're crossing the desert, then the command came down, leave them here. So he didn't really know where he was going with them, but he was told to go in a certain direction. And he went that direction until they found themselves in the desert. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, leave them there. But the others, they also mentioned that if he did receive the message beforehand, he didn't tell her because he didn't want to complicate things and that he would want to explain to her later and she would understand. Allahu alam. But either way, she was in a state of submission to Allah's command. And he was not of a nature to trick or deceive somebody. So it's we don't think that Ibrahim alayhi salam intentionally deceived her and then took her away, Allahu alam. But when Allah commanded him to do something, he did it, I hope that makes sense. There's a bug coming around. It's bothering me, alhamdulillah. And sometimes flies is a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِي أَن يَضْرِبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُودَةً فَمَا فَوْقَهَا. Allah doesn't hesitate to give you as a sign something as small as a fly or something even smaller than that. And what's amazing is one of the Mufassirin said, if you're engaged in seeking knowledge and you reach a point where you have doubts, you don't know if it's this way or that way, and a fly comes to you, that's a sign that you're in the right course. So what were we talking about when the fly just showed up? Whether Ibrahim alayhi salam received the message while he was with his wife, or he received it later. So he probably was told, because that's when the fly came, right? When he was at the desert, that now leave them here. So Allahu alam, Allah knows best. Any other questions besides the bug? Alhamdulillah. So I'm going to turn it over to you guys. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from us. Jazakallah khair. Go ahead, inshallah. Conclude it for us.
Thank you. I just want to add one small comment. With Eid al-Adha passing, it was nice to hear Hazrat Ibrahim's story again. It was really insightful, because whenever we listen to it or we recount it, we know what's going to happen. We know how it ends. We know how it goes. But with in the moment, Hazrat Ibrahim, when he dropped off Hazrat Hajar and Hazrat Ismail in the desert, he didn't know what was going to happen. When he dropped off, when he was about to sacrifice Hazrat Ismail, he didn't know what was going to happen. These were like real intense moments that really tested his faith. And I think that's why we celebrate them. So I just wanted to add that. So Jazakallah khair, Brother Shay, for the lecture. Zakhla here, everyone, for coming, and we'll see everyone in 2 weeks, inshallah.
Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.